Okay, in our last class, we were the necessity of man, really. Why God needs a man. And we were finishing off with that scripture in Isaiah where it says God was looking at everything and that there was no man. That was what he's looking for, because he did give man dominion and he can't take it back. And Satan usurped that dominion, but he actually used basically the same method that God would have dominion through man. In other words, man would have dominion, but not randomly, not just do whatever you want. God didn't give man dominion and just say, do whatever you want. There was an understanding that it would be under him, that he was God and man was man, and man had dominion over the earth, and if you will, God had dominion over man. Okay? And so the last part of that verse that we read was, but so then his arm sent forth salvation and strength, and that is in the form of a man. If you'll turn with me to 1 Timothy chapter 2. Verse 5. And the scripture says this: for there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus. I remember when I read this scripture for the first time and understood what it was saying, that it was rather earth-shaking, in a sense. Because up to that point in my walk with the Lord, everything that I was trying to prove about Jesus was that he was God. Okay? You understand what I'm saying? That, you know, they're all saying he's a man, and everything I was trying to prove is this is God. All right. Then I read this. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man. Look at that. The man. Christ Jesus. The man. And I went, come on, man. You're not helping our cause here. You know, can you see how that would be? You know, and that's really the mentality of a lot of Christians. And yet there's a reason why this scripture is specifically calling him the man, Christ Jesus, is because he is that mediator. He is that intercessor. He is that intervener. He is the one that God sent to remedy all of the things that Isaiah 59 was talking about, and all of the lack and all of the lack of dominion, or the lack of government in the people of God. And so Jesus came back to bring back the government of God. Not just picture Jesus coming back, not doing any what he did. Just he comes back to the earth and he says, I represent man for on behalf of God, and I'm going to set up a kingdom. And we all go, yay! And so he sets up a throne, and he goes, okay, now I'm the boss. Okay, now here's what you do. Quit your lying. Quit your cheating, you cheating squaws. Don't be hurting people anymore. Don't be doing this. Don't be doing that. You see what I'm saying? And so everybody leaves the throne and goes out to live their own life. And what do? They do exactly what they did before, because that's their nature. That's the fallen nature. Or, can I say it like this? That's the government that the enemy uses to have dominion over the earth. And he controls everything and everybody because he knows what will motivate people. You know, power and pride and all this kind of stuff. And so, people, you know, I mean, I've had people say to me, well, why did Jesus even come and die? I mean, why did he even come back to the earth? You know, I mean, didn't he know everybody'd kill him? You know? Why didn't he just open the heavens, show him sitting on a big throne, and say to everybody, "You ignorant savages, I created you. I'm the boss. Now do what I say, or," and then open this big opening in the sky like a black hole and show, you know, the hell, and, you know, and the lake of fire, and say, "Now that's where you're going to end up if you don't do what I'm going to say." Now that's kind of a picture many preachers give. But he didn't do that. You know why? Because God gave dominion to man, and man lost it, and man was going to have to bring it back again. Where is that? 2 Corinthians 5, like 22, or let's see if we can find that. I'm pretty sure it's 2 Corinthians. I can't even find 2 Corinthians. Do y'all have that in your Bible? Oh, no. You know what I'm talking about? I'm talking about 1 Corinthians 15. Sorry, but... yeah. 1 Corinthians 15, 21. "For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive." Now, we have just been explained the eternal plan of God in a very few words right there. He said, by man, and that is Adam, by the first man, Adam, death came, and sin came, and failure came, and a break with the government of God, meaning not being governed by God's nature, which we call what? Christ in. Not being governed by God's nature, Christ in you. It's not, he doesn't give us his nature, folks. He gives us Christ. And Christ lives in us. And if Christ doesn't live in us, even if he's in us, we are living by the wrong nature. We're still living by the first nature, the first man. Okay? So it says, by man. He didn't, this isn't really trying to, right at this point, emphasize Adam. This is just trying to say, God gave dominion to man. God did this thing through man, and man blew it, and man's going to have to do it. God can't just reach down from heaven through the clouds, grab someone up by the hair of their head and say, "We don't do it that way," because he didn't have that right anymore. Right. He gave it to man.
That's right.
So, since death came by man, doggone it, then the remedy is going to have to come through man too. Since by man came death, to man, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. Okay? And so, why did Jesus have to be a man? Because man had to do it. God was not going to take it back. God was not going to grab control of it again and say, "You people don't know what you're doing. You're all a mess." Does that sound like anybody you know? The gods of this world are always trying to grab everything by the throat and shape it up. "Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ." Oh, this is where we get the kenosis theory. It's not a theory, it's a reality. "Who being formed and fashioned as a man, humbled himself." And then he went further and became obedient. And then he went further, even unto death. And then he went further, even unto the death of the cross. "Wherefore, God hath highly exalted him." The key word is him. Who is the him that God highly exalted? Who is that him? That's a man. Read it, Philippians 2. It's the kenosis scriptures that we'll read bunches of times here. That him is the Jesus that became a man. This whole plan of God depends on a man, and depends not just on a man, but I'm going to say it like this for now. We'll clarify as we go. But depends on bringing man back to the place where God, to what he had in mind for man all along. So there has to be an intercession, there has to be a mediator, there has to be one that stands between God and man, but is man. He can't just be God. Must be man to be able to bring about what it is that God always wanted for man. And he looked and he couldn't find any man. So as it were, he made his own man. He brought forth his own man. And that man was Jesus Christ. The man, what did it say? The man, Christ Jesus. That's what it said. And the reason why that verse emphasized, because there are verses that emphasize Jesus as the Son of God, amen? But we miss this whole thing. I mean, Jesus, I've never counted it, but probably hundreds of times Jesus calls himself the Son of Man. Son of Man. He continually does it. And I would challenge you to look at it. If you had some cheap Bible that you didn't use a lot and was probably not very reliable, I would just go through and circle Son of Man every time Jesus says it or there's a reference to it. And you'll be shocked because many of the scriptures that you would think it would be speaking of the Son of God. For example, you know, when the Son of Man comes back in the air, we're going, no, the Son of God is going to come back. The Son of God is going to come back. He's going to come back and say, I'm God, and God's in control. We're all going to go, God wins, and God's people win. See, that's a big painted picture of something that's based totally not on the kenosis of Christ and the plan of God in relationship to having to make Jesus a man so that a man comes back. And that's what it says. When the Son of Man sits on the throne at the right hand of God, Son of Man, a resurrected man is now sitting at the right hand of God. I mean, this stuff messes with simplistic, not simple, but simplistic theology. Simplistic theology. I don't think it has to be complicated. I think things can be simple, but I don't think God meant them to be simplistic. God knows what he's doing. He's working this plan, and this plan depends on Jesus, the man. And we need to recognize that because, why? Because we're all brought into this. We're all brought into this plan of God. So, and you can see that. Let's go ahead and move to that, to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. All right, so so the plan of God was for a man, or you can say the plan of God was for mankind to function under God, but by the government of God. Now, many Christians hear that, and so they say, yeah, the government of God is the Ten Commandments. No, the government of God is the nature of God. Folks, there is no, you know, let me draw God over here. There is no God and then, you know, certain truths and ideas and don't steal, don't lie, don't cheat, don't do this, don't do that. And these principles govern God, or these laws govern God. God has Ten Commandments in front of you and he goes, well, I don't see it. Because I keep this stuff. these tables God. Does that make sense? That would, I mean, if he's adhering to the, if God is adhering to these tables of stone, these Ten Commandments, then they're God. They're dictating. And God is just a servant of those things. Am I right or wrong? There are no guiding principles in the sense of rules that we keep. There is only the one whose nature it is, which these rules came out when man said to God at the Mount Sinai. Moses says, well, you know, God's up there. Let's go up and meet with God. No, no, no. You go up there and you get the instructions and come tell us. We're afraid of God. Well, that's because you're contrary to him. But so he goes, okay, and he goes out and says, Lord, they don't really want to see you face to face and get changed into your same image, so I'm going to have to put a veil on my face after spending time with you because the glory of this thing is you on me. So he put a veil over his face and brought the tables of stone back. Said, well, if you just want to know what to do, here's what to do. But that was never the plan. The plan was what happened to Moses, and that is, and that's what he describes, be changed into that same image from glory to glory by the Spirit of the Lord. Is that not? I'm just telling you scriptures now. This is Paul's explanation of the events that took place. You know, I didn't even come up with this. I'm not smart enough to come up with this. Paul saw this from the Lord, and he saw that the true plan of God didn't involve the law. Tables of stone, commandments. He said, there's a way of getting what God wants without the law. There is? Yeah, the new rules is what we say. You know, it's the new set of rules. It's the Christian rules. It's not based on rules. It's based on life. There's only one life that fulfills what God wants. So, here's the plan of God. That plan is for God in the, there's two phases to this. Number one, phase one is the incarnation. Number two is the new creation. Incarnation, in case it didn't come over the page. Two phases to this. Phase one, the incarnation. Phase two, the new creation. Jesus' coming did not fulfill the eternal plan of God. Did it? Jesus' coming put away the old, and his resurrection started the new. Amen. To start the ball rolling, there had to be a man. What does incarnation mean? It comes from the word, in Spanish, it's carne, which means flesh, or man. The manning up of Jesus, the fact that he came as a man. And as such, now he's the only one on the planet that is fulfilling God's plan for man. Does that make sense?
Yes.
He's the only one. Now, that man is doing that because he's got, remember I drew the tables of stone and then I drew God. He's got the nature of this thing. You know, to you, the Ten Commandments say this, thou shalt not steal. To Jesus, they say, thou will not steal. Thou shalt not steal. Because he won't. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is a nature thing with him. He doesn't steal. He gives. He blesses. We steal because we want what he's got or what they've got or what somebody else. That's, you know, jealousy, all those things. accounts of those things come out of selfishness. Jealousy is only a selfish thing because it says, well, I want that, or you've got something I want. Covetousness, same thing, all of it. Stealing comes up. It all comes out of this same spirit. There's very little self-giving going on in Christianity. Can I get an amen on that? God, there's very little of it going on. And we're just describing, we're describing the eternal plan of God here. We're describing exactly the heartbeat of this whole thing. In all the classes that we've had, this answers to it. So, God sent one man. And that man walked in a manner that fulfilled. Jesus didn't keep the law. He fulfilled the law. What's the difference? Keeping is God's Ten Commandments in front of you, and you're saying you're God, and you understand what I mean by that. You're higher than me, and therefore I submit to you. These tables of stone are God, and I will do what they are. That's keeping. But fulfilling is that he was everything that the law meant. He's the fulfillment of it. He didn't even have to look at them.
That's right.
He didn't have to figure them out or read them or go, I'm just studying this so I can get it. Folks, we need to study the word so we see Jesus, not so we get it. Amen. Okay. So he does that. Completely satisfies the Father. He's everything that you want, but there's still a problem. He's the only one. So how are we going to get rid of all of the men that are not what God wants and bring forth a bunch that are? All of that is done by oneness. By one man, all men sin by the sin of one man. Does it not say that in Romans 5? Mm-hmm. By the obedience or the disobedience of one man, all da 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 da. One means oneness. We were one with him, one in the sense of, the same kind. The example I think of, I came to the Lord in the 60s and was a hippie. We prided ourselves in the fact that we were different. Okay. So when I first heard this teaching about all men are the same, all men are the same in Adam, it ruffled my feathers. It ruffled my feathers because I wasn't like the system. I wasn't like the man. I wasn't like them. And then it occurred to me, we're all exactly alike. We all want to be happy. We all want to be comfortable. We don't want any pain. You start describing it, you go, my God, we're all exactly the same. I can curl my hair, and I still got the same traits that Adam does in you. You see what I'm saying? Or I can make a mohawk and make it rainbow colors. And it's still Adam riding underneath it. Okay. So there's this oneness factor. And oneness, if you will, became the downfall of all of us, but oneness became the savior of us all too. It's a beautiful thing. Because this incarnated, this one man went to the cross and he took by oneness all of the old creation there, and in one fell swoop he wiped out all men that were contrary to God. And the thing that impressed me, that the Lord impressed me with, was he sort of spoke this to me once. He said, the cross is God's judgment on how well man did. And that is, every one of your flakes and feathers. Do you remember what we read in Isaiah 59? That's pretty much, all men other, I'm trying to remember how it's quoted there just before Noah's time, but every thought and imagination of man was nothing but evil only. And when we say evil, it's not like, it's just that purity of selfishness. It is, and again, I try to make a distinction between selfishness and self-centeredness, because selfishness in our mind is that we're just, it's just me, me, me all the time. Whereas self-centeredness is that, but what it does is it does it more righteously. It says, you know, let's see, what do I want to be involved with in the church? Well, only areas that interest me. There it is. There it is. Would you, somebody who dislikes kids or never wanted kids or whatever, would you like to work with the kids? Oh, no, 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 no. Well, do you think it might be Christ to, no, 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 I, baby. No. You know, and that's, but we never recognize that as selfishness. But it is totally self-centered, meaning I, you know, all my relationships, have you ever heard this term networking? It used to be big several years ago, but I mean networking. What you do is everybody you meet, you try to make a contact out of them, and you try to build from that, and pretty soon you've got all these contacts and stuff like that. Oh, let's see, Facebook, maybe that's networking, maybe all of that.
Social media.
And basically, you make a contact. He was networking in business. Now it's called a friend. Is that right? Is that what the? Is that? I don't know. I'm not on there because they would kill me.
Yeah.
No, there's no doubt about it. A friend. Is that it? Really?
Yeah.
Is that, okay. Now Jesus gives us the true definition of a friend when he says, "Greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friend." Is everybody on your list? Would they go to the cross for you? Then you need to quit kidding yourself and playing games in the world. They're not your friend. You need to start marking people off. Okay. I've said that's my saying. But I mean, I'm telling you that some of the people right now, today, that are on your list that you think are really your friends because they joined your thing. They're going to turn on you, and they're going to use the fact that they're a friend and they have an in to put stuff about you that's going to rip you and hurt you, and you're not going to know how to get it off of there, and it's going to influence people, and it's all going to turn on you. How can we avoid that? Well, we just go by Jesus' definition of a friend. Anyone who's willing to lay down their life for me to literally go to the cross, there's my friend. Well, you know, you said, but the whole goal is to have a big list of people. You think all those people are your friends? That's just dumb. If you really reduce it down, you'll probably have one name, Jesus. Amen. You know? You just have one name. Now, no, I'm not telling you to get off Facebook or whatever, although I guarantee some of you, I guarantee right here in this room, not just watching this, are going to regret the day you ever did what you did by opening the door to so many people, because somebody's going to turn on you and they're going to hurt you bad, and you're not going to be able to shake it out of the tree because you've opened that door. Okay? Just letting you know. But enjoy Facebook. Gather as many people as you can. Ignore anything that I would say, and because it's not really based on what I say. But if you hear the warning of God, I would suggest you, Scott's sitting back there. I bet you, if I turned him loose up here, if I called him up here and just had him talk for a few minutes, about it, I bet you he'd rip you one. I bet he would. I don't believe he'd just talk. I bet he'd rip you one side and down the other. With truth and reality, because he's been there. And still fighting walls of demons that have come through that little hole. So, sorry, I wasn't planning on going there. Okay. But I try to be led of the Lord. All right, so we're in Ephesians 4. So this goal is, let's go to verse 12. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come. Okay, so it's talking about saints, and it's talking about the work of the ministry, but it's talking about that all of that ends up being this building up of the body of Christ, not the building up of saints in ministry. Let me read it again. There's two things it's talking about: saints in ministry and building up the body of Christ to become the vehicle of the life of Christ, to become the expressor of his nature. Till we all come, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the building up of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a, not many perfect men, a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Folks, the only measure that you'll ever measure up to is Christ. He must be the measure of God. He is the measure of God. And if we fall short of that, we do not measure up. We are found wanting. Drop down to verse 16. From whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part. All right, so here we're getting an idea that this body thing, this resurrection body, remember, the creation was done in 7 days? Well, there, God has begun a process. In this body thing or bride thing, it's just all in the angle that you look at. It's all one thing. It's one with Christ, and he lives in her. He lives in it. He lives in her, the bride. He lives in it, the body. They are one. Okay. So it's saying, from whom? Who do you think the whom is there? That's Jesus. From whom the whole body comes together and gets the life. The proof of that is, you know, my hand goes, well, I can't get along with that kneecap down. And the foot says, I can't get along with it. Well, if you take Jesus out of that body, nothing works. Mm-hmm. If you take me out of my body, nothing works. If you take Jesus out of his body, nothing works. Mm-hmm. Okay. It goes back to Adamic default. It goes back to a pre-cross default. Man against man. Man's inhumanity to man. Man's, you know, that's what it does. Okay? So, this I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you henceforth not walk as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened. Okay? So, is he talking to Adam? He's talking to those who are now his body, and they're saying, look, I'm telling you, I'm testifying in union with the Lord, or these truths are coming based on union with the Lord. Don't walk as other Gentiles, because they are walking in vanity of their own mind, as if they're all individuals with their own little thing going, and their understanding is darkened. But the real problem is they are alienated from the life of God. He just said, from whom the whole body, folks, every line of this is going in oneness. In other words, in incarnation, there was one man, and that man was Jesus in his earth body. In resurrection or in new creation, there's still only one man, the man Jesus Christ, but we're his body. We're the members of his body. He lives in every one of us. He governs every part of his body. You know, could you see Jesus walking down the road with his disciples, and then he starts going, well, you know, that Thaddeus, my God, he's got this part of his being that just rattles on and puts down people and says negative things, and then he goes, oh, no, I think every part is governed by his nature, by his spirit. We do that stuff. And we do that because all this stuff, the cross and the death and the resurrection and the new man, is not reality to us. It's teaching, it's doctrine, we may hold it, but it's not reality to us. It's just good teaching. And my God, people, there are people that really love the teaching of this place. And they love the teaching of that place over there, now too, the ones that teach Christ in the manner that we do. They love us less. I'm going to tell you why now. Because in many places that teach the same stuff, don't put expectations that it be Christ. You just teach. And just let everybody live. They can lie, they can live selfishly, they can talk back, they can do whatever they want. And believe the glorious doctrines of this. They believe the chalkboard. But the way I preach it, you can't get away. You know, I mean, you can't. And it's bad. It's bad on those who would just love to just hold this stuff. But this is not chalkboard. This is the eternal plan of God. This is everything that is in his heart. This is all the reason why Jesus died. It is the reason why he rose in resurrection. It is all concerning his son and oneness with his son. And if that doesn't become a reality in the way, because I mean, listen to what he's saying, you know, walk not as other Gentiles, you know, apparently Paul had trouble too. Because he's putting an emphasis on living this, not just learning. Well, let's continue. Verse 19. Who being past dealing have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanness of greediness, but you have not so learned Christ. He didn't say you have not learned the Ten Commandments that way. Or you didn't learn the Christian doctrine that way. He's got one thing on his mind. You didn't learn Christ. This new man is Christ. It's who you are. It's your only hope of escape. And Peter says that in what is the first chapter, I think, of maybe it's 2 Peter, but it might be 1 Peter, where he talks about having escaped the lust and the grasp of the this world and everything. And he says, you did it through the divine nature. Here, that's Peter's version. Paul's version is, and these are men of God, no, they're not. They're the apostles of Jesus Christ who expressed to us the true and living way. Paul says, but you didn't learn Christ that way. This isn't about learning truths or right or thing. This is, did you learn Christ? If you learn the truths, if you learn the doctrine of it, if you can quote all this stuff and still are constantly contrary to it, then you never learn Christ. Now your goal should be to know Jesus, not to learn the teachings of this Bible school or this church.
Amen.
Man, what a failure it would be if you just learned the doctrines and the teachings of it. Because the end result would be when you have not so learned Christ. You didn't learn Christ. You didn't see Jesus in this. So he says, but you have not so learned Christ, if so be that you've heard him and been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus, or the truth is in union with Jesus. In other words, there is no truth. Just like in the Old Covenant, there were no Ten Commandments that were God, only the nature of God. In the New Testament, there are no set of truths that are God, only in union. In, you have not so, what is it, as the truth is in Jesus, this thing only happens by being in union, in Christ. That you put off concerning the former manner of life, the old man, there it is. You put off this old nature by how? Very carnal example, very carnal, very small picture of that. If you have a problem smoking, you start, you use the patch or something. And so you replace it, or you chew nicotine gum, or you chew gum. If you have a problem with eating, you get another hobby or something like that. You replace it with something else. Well, in this case, it's the only possible way. The only way to get rid of this nature is it must be replaced. But the only way you can replace it is not by going to the store and saying, I'd like to exchange this. here's the old man. You must go not to the store, but to the cross. And every individual has to do that in the manner that Paul did when he said, I am crucified with Christ. Every one of you have to get to the point where you say, I am crucified, not because I taught it or Paul taught it, but because you have seen it so deliberately and so clearly from the Holy Spirit that you understand why that incarnated man had to come, and you saw that he came back, as it were, in a new form, a new man, not new men. You know, you never see the scriptures, it never says we are new men. Did you know that? Have you ever noticed that? It says new man, one new man. It's one new man, and we are the body of that new man, and he's the life. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the truth and the life. Whoa. Okay, again, I'm trying to make a point here. Christianity doesn't have a set of truths that we follow. Jesus said, I am the truth. Okay. But if the truth were we should pray, then do we just do that because we're told to by commandments, which is exactly if you write it on stone and tell me to do it? Or do we do that? Yes, it's important to do those things, but we do them by Christ. We pray when it's the Lord to. And you'll know that many times. Man, you'll know, man, I need to pray. Or I need to get in the Word. You know, those things are dictated by life, not by laws or truths. Because truths, Christian New Testament truths, can be treated by you exactly the same way as the Ten Commandments were treated by the Jews. You haven't changed systems. You just changed, you know, instead of going to the synagogue, now you go to the church. And instead of reading the Old Testament, I read the New One. Instead of praying to Jehovah, now I pray to Jesus.
That's right.
And that's the difference. Changed his name, changed his book name, and changed his building name, and that does it. I'm shocked if that's all there is to it. Wow, that's easy. But I got news for you. It's not that. It's much more than that. And I haven't even fully finished here, but I mean, here it is. Put off the, verse 22, that you put off concerning the former manner of life. That's the actual rendering of those scriptures. Okay. What is your former manner of life? Well, the same things you used to do when you were not born again. Okay, well, you say, well, I don't do those. I don't, you know, like in my case, well, I used to smoke and I don't smoke. Not that it makes any difference, but, you know, I used to do drugs and I don't do drugs now. Did I put off the former manner of life?
No.
Well, the truth is, if my way of handling something is lying, or covering up, or, you understand what I'm saying? If that's my manner, if that was my manner then, and I'm still using it, even though I'm doing it in a Christian way, where you can't see it, it's not as obvious, you know what I mean? Then I haven't put off the old man, because the old man, folks, I love Colossians on this point. In chapter 3, when he starts talking about put off the old man, he starts describing what it is. He says, lasciviousness and selfishness and dead. I mean, he starts going through this long list and goes, just in case you wanted to know what putting off the old man is, it's that you stop all of this stuff. Yeah. I mean, you got to love that.
Amen.
Because it is possible to be a great Bible teacher and say, put off the old man, and never hit any of these points. And so it's okay that, you know, I mean, I do them, and so why would I want to tell you specifically to stop? As long as I tell you the doctrine of it, everything's good. But, and I will tell you, as honestly as I can from my heart, I am not teaching these things to you. I stand up here and do this and share this because I try to preach what I've been practicing. I know that's hard for some people to believe, but I'm sorry. I do it almost moment by moment of every day. I want Jesus. You know, we say, I want Jesus, you know. I mean, I've been taught, this is half the happen where I've gone into places and they say, oh, I just want to lift Jesus up. So we get up there and we start preaching Christ like this, and we lift him too high. And they don't want, I want Jesus lifted up, but only like this high. I don't want him, Christ, all and in all. But that's the scripture. That's the word of God. That's what it's supposed to be. To live anything short of that. And again, I can't fully put that on you. I can only tell you that that's the word. Only you can put that on me. I actually give you the freedom to live like hell if you want to. You just go, let her rip, baby. I mean, really, I do. But I shared Jesus, and if something in your heart says, I want that, then you'll go after that on your own way, and you'll get the Lord, But this is mostly about, to me, not a ministry or anything else. It is what I endeavor to have worked into my life, because I know if I teach this stuff and don't get it worked into my life, I can't, I'm so messed up over that, I would freak out to think that I was doing that. It would destroy me from the inside. And that doesn't, you say, well, you're talking about yourself or whatever. I'm just trying to let you know that from my motive is not trying to shake you up. That's what I'm trying to say more than anything else. I'm not trying to shake you up. You follow the Lord with what you sense and feel. You have free will. But God did use me to raise up this place. And this is the kind of stuff he used me to teach. And he says, this is what I want. And I do it with all my heart, soul, and strength. And as long as this place exists, I believe if I drop and the torch falls to the ground, I believe there are people right here that will pick it right back up, carry it on, and keep this light shining forth. Because we're not a little church in Denton, Texas that is meaningless. We are the body of Christ. We are. And I'll close with this. Let's see. It's over in Ephesians 1. So we're in Ephesians. Turn to Ephesians 1. The last two verses in Ephesians 1, verse 22 and 23. And hath put all things under his feet, talking about Jesus' feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. I want you to grasp what that is saying. First of all, it's describing what's under his feet, and that's not us. We are his feet. We are his body. It's saying that in the very next verse. It's Ephesians 1, 22 and 23. And gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body. Okay, right there, that little phrase. The church, which is his body. He is so specific, it's just earthshaking. He didn't say to the church, the organization that follows his teaching. He didn't say he gave all this to the church, the true believers. He, when he talks about the church, he's talking about that which is his body that lets him live in that. And he goes on to say, because it's the fullness of him. In other words, they express his fullness. It is the vehicle of the expression of his fullness that filleth all in all. And we read that and it's all doctrinal. It's all, yes, he did that 2,000 years ago. My God, what a wonderful thing that he did. This isn't doctrinal. This is right now the reality. And I don't take that and look at another group or another church in town or another church anywhere and say, you're not the church, you're not. I say, we must be the church, which is his body. and the bullets of him that filled the hole. That's what we was. Yeah, God will sort out what's what. God will sort out what. You cannot be, and I cannot be, responsible for everything that goes on in every church in this town and in this world. We can't even be responsible for everything that goes on in this church. But you are responsible for everything that goes on in that one member of the church, which is his body. Called you, that member. You can press on. Have you, you know, Paul says, I've not yet attained. Have you attained yet? Neither have I. Neither have I. But you can press on. Just keep pressing on. That's what you do. That's what you do. It's an old Arab saying, but it says the journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step. You say, but I'm so far. Take a step, and then take another step, and take a step, and just keep going, and you'll be surprised how far you are. And one day you look at, oh my God, but all you were doing was taking one little step, just one little step, and keeping going after the Lord, and you'll be amazed at how quickly you will make ground. But if you look at the full task, you're going to faint. Just look at Jesus and say, Lord, I want you. I'm after you. I want to be, you know, I want the church to be your body, the fullness of you that filleth all. But I can't make the church that. I can only make this one member, which is me, that. And so I'm going to set my course to do that right now. We will pray, but we need to pray also for Kelly because she's about to leave tomorrow, I guess, to go to Ireland, and she's going to be over there 3 weeks?
A little over two.
And when is Ben leaving?
He leaves a week from today.
Okay, so we've got, we can pray for him later on. Why don't you come forward and we'll pray for you. And those of you that feel led, let's just lay hands on her and ask the Lord to use this vessel of him and to bring forth the things that are in his heart. And a lot of times we have an idea of what that is, but only the Lord fully knows, and that's why we did this praying, because we want everything in his hands. And I know that Kelly does too. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you for what you've done in Ireland, more specifically what you've done in the hearts of different people there in that country, and how they were heading one direction, and then they met Kelly and Fire Ministries, and now their lives are completely turned in a different direction, and they're going your way, seeking your face, and wanting your life manifested through them. Father, we just pray for this trip, and we ask that you guide Kelly, not guide her as a guide dog or as a great God from above, but guide her as the particular member that she is of your body that will go and be that extension of you. And Father, the other members that will come later, and people like Matt coming from Arizona, Lord, that each one of them will be fitly joined together to accomplish your purposes and your plans. Father, I just pray that you will, at the same moment that you're using her and them, that you will refresh them. And Lord, that there will be rest and that there will be an ease in the process instead of a burden and instead of wearing themselves out. And Father, I just thank you for your mind that is attached to every member to be able to receive your heart and what you're thinking and what you really want. And so, Father, just be glorified in this trip. Be glorified. Be greatly honored. And Lord, may it just be the sweet savor of Christ to you, Father. May it just be so sweet to you that it's Jesus. And Lord, may it not be so much all the ministry things that we accomplish that is so important, but that it be the release of Christ in all that we do that is that sweet savor to you. Father, there are areas that may arise, whether they be financial or physical or whatever. We don't know all of the things that can happen, but we know that you do, and we know that if you didn't, you are still sufficient for everything. And so we ask you, Father, to meet the need, to be the leader that you are through Kelly, Father, as she leads this team, and that Father, she will have the satisfaction of knowing that this brought you glory by Christ Jesus. Father, we put it all into your hands. We ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. And Father, I just pray now for the rest of us here that the things that you spoke, not what I spoke during these classes, but the things that you spoke that reached different hearts, Lord, not that they would be condemned, but they would be challenged. Challenged because they love you to break forth more into your reality, to have their mind more renewed, to have their actions more challenged by life, and then brought forth what it is that's in your heart. Father, we just pray that your purpose for having these things shared tonight will not return into your void, but they will accomplish the purpose to which you sent. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And somebody said, thank God, from now on, bring the notes.